You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Don Gauthier. Welcome to SMT 312, Natural Disasters. And we are now in lecture 5 of our class, and we're talking, continuing to talk about volcanoes. We introduced the topic last week, and we are in session 6. That was last week. We're in session 6 today, October 14th. So, welcome. I'm going to remind you that we're a part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, and that our classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we'll be broadcasting 4 classes, Communications 365, Introduction to Public Relations, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Labor 412, Labor Law, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m., Sociology 315, The Sociology of Work, on Sundays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m., and Science, Math, and Technology, this class, Natural Disasters, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you may be eligible to complete your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then, well, we start all over again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv, or you can call 1-866-278-6789, and the friendly people there will be glad to help you out and answer your questions. So, that being said, I do want to remind you, too, that you can get a hold of me during the class by calling 800-339-1193, and I invite anyone to call. You don't have to be a student or registered in the class in order to, you know, kind of interact with me or the class itself. To ask questions or to make comments, you're more than welcome to do that. I'm glad to have you participate in that way, my students as well. There's also a website that you can go to. You can send us an email at askdhtv@gmail.com, and you can put a question to me that way. A lot of people tend to prefer that, I guess. It's the days of texting, so you can also tweet me, and you can send it to DHTV Live. So it's at DHTV Live. And I have an email address myself, so you can also email me at dgsmt312@gmail.com with questions that you may have about the course, or for students in particular, this is the way to get a hold of me. Those are all the ways that you can contact me today or, you know, during the class. Now, once this is done, you can go to youtube.com and you can watch this over again. I know that you just love seeing this twice, but if you miss it and you want to kind of get filled in on what we covered this week, that's the best way to do it. Go to youtube.com/CSUDHTV and you can just type in SMT312 or, you know, whatever, and you should be able to find it right there, right on your fingertips. And you're going to want to look at Lecture 6 today, because that's what we're going to be talking about, volcanoes. Last time, as we began to look at volcanoes, we talked a little bit in general about how our perception of them has changed over time. And in the past, volcanoes were seen as simply vents that would release, you know, hot gases and lava and you know, other things into the atmosphere and onto the land. That really came from the Earth cooling down, that, you know, the Earth had a fiery interior. And, of course, in mythology, this is the realm, you know, the realm of Hades and, you know, the gods of the underworld. And it's where our vision, you know, of hell comes from, right? From volcanoes, which is really the only way that we had to kind of peer down into the interior of the Earth from, on, you know, from a safe relatively safe, I guess, perch to look down into a volcano and see what was down below. But in more recent times, with the development of a theory that's very comprehensive called plate tectonics, we have a more realistic view of not only where volcanoes occur and why they occur where they do, but we also have a better understanding of how they function. And we are, in fact, going to be talking about the different types of volcanoes today. And so, just as a way of kind of introducing today, I'd like to go through our course objectives and to talk about, you know, by the end of a class today, you should have the ability to describe the different types of volcanoes and their different features, because they all have their own features and characteristics. You should also be able to explain the relationship between volcanoes and plate tectonics, how they're kind of linked. You should also be able to recognize the effects of volcanoes and their links to other hazards. And then finally, you should be able to enumerate some of the historic eruptions and their impacts on society, and how they've impacted humans since that time as well. And have we learned our lessons or not? Well, we'll see. And last time we talked about the different types of lava. We also noted that lava was magma at the surface. That molten rock below the surface is called magma. When it comes up to the surface, it's lava. That lava can appear in two basic types, what we call a'a, which is the rough-edged, glassy, kind of fragmented material, and the pahoehoe, which is the kind of rope-like, smooth consistency of lava, kind of coming out in glops, you know, in kind of braided rope fashion. That's why it's called pahoehoe. We also made note of the fact that different lavas are the product of different magmas and different types of material that's being melted below the surface, and how much it mixes with continental or oceanic rocks, whatever, you know, the case may be, and how much is transformed and how it affects the characteristics or properties of the lava. So today we continue with our discussion of volcanoes, and we also noted that last week that we have volcanoes that are extinct, that do not erupt because there's no longer any source of magma. We have inactive, or what we call dormant, volcanoes. These are capable of erupting, but they are not at the present time. And then we have what we call active volcanoes. These are the ones that are in the process of erupting. So this is how we kind of differentiate between them. So let's talk about the types of volcanoes. And we'll begin with the largest type of volcano. This generally occurs in what we call oceanic settings. This type of volcano, and this chart kind of lays it out for you, is known as a shield volcano, and it's a very large volcano. In fact, Mauna Loa, Mauna Kea is the kind of big mountain. When we take it down to the seafloor, this is a huge mountain. And it has the, it's a shield volcano because of its shape. That's why we get the name shield volcano. It's broad, and it's made up of mostly basaltic lava, so it tends to follow a kind of contour. So you have this kind of broad mountain that goes down to the ocean floor, and it adds to itself and grows kind of in layers and in sporadic caldera eruptions, where we get lava flowing out of the caldera, which is the kind of pot in which the lava boils. And here's, this diagram shows us the different types of rocks and how they contribute to various components and various types of components of lava, and how they contribute to the shape. And so in some cases we have basaltic, and that's where the shield volcano is here. So you have the basalt and shield. And of course this has increasing temperature, so hot material. It has the consistency more of water than of peanut butter. And of course our more volatile or more explosive ones are up here in the dome the dome volcanoes. And in between, we have our composites, and they're made up of alternating layers of material. And of course, the material itself tells us how it's going to behave. So the rhyolitic material here is going to produce a more explosive type of volcano, the volcano dome. Yubi-Hibi Crater in the Death Valley National Monument is a huge crater. It was a rhyolitic material all over the place. And then if you go to Hawaii, of course, you'll see the darker colored basaltic type of lavas that make up, you know, the beaches there as well. So we have this variation in terms of the origins and the kind of material that we're starting with. But shield volcanoes are, again, these very large and dominant types of volcanoes. In this image, you can see the very broad and very gradual slope of that volcano. That's how you know you're looking at a shield volcano. And again, most of them occur in oceanic settings. So here, you know, the Big Island of Hawaii, you can see this broad shape. A lot of the other volcanic islands out in, you know, the Atlantic Ocean and in the Pacific have the same kind of shape, especially where they're in the right kind of setting, where they're getting the right type of lava. And these are less explosive. They do erupt over long periods of time. So the Kilauea Rift eruption has been going on continuously since 1979, producing more and more lava. And of course, the island is growing. But as we mentioned, I think the off the coast, we have another, you know, these are what we call vent eruptions. This is mostly what's taking place at Kilauea. We have material coming up to the surface there. This is our caldera. This is that bowl near the top. And occasionally, you know, this will overflow and flow down in a kind of layer. So you can see the different layers that make up the shield volcano here. And with the hot vents sometimes creating what we call flank or vent eruptions on the sides. So that's our shield volcano. So as we have a little video that will talk about these and give you some examples, and then we'll come back and, you know, finish up with shield volcanoes.
It's a tropical paradise of palm trees, sand, and sun. But it's even hotter than it looks. In the heart of this island is Kilauea, the world's most active volcano. Kilauea's lava and lava from the island's older volcanoes, Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa, built this island, and it's still growing. It all started here, deep below the bottom of the ocean. A hot spot in the Earth's mantle sends molten magma through the Earth's crust. Over time, lava flows on the Big Island have produced a mountain taller than Mount Everest, if you measure from the sea floor. All of the Hawaiian Islands were formed in this way. A volcano is one way that the heat inside the Earth is released. The heat moves in the form of gushing lava, which flows freely in swelling waves down the mountain, and in this case, into the ocean. Kilauea is known as a shield volcano because of the way its fluid, basaltic lava builds up layer upon layer, spreading out in the form of a shield. Lava from Kilauea flows freely because it is low in silica and its temperature is high. As the lava flows, anything in its path goes up in flames. Kilauea's current eruption began in 1983 and shows no signs of stopping. Its lava hardens into acres of new land every year. Kilauea's volcanic power comes from a hot spot in the Earth's mantle. But shield volcanoes are not the most common or the most explosive kind of volcano.
And we'll find out which ones those are in just a second. So there's our view of Hawaii and a shield volcano example. Again, there are many of them around the world, but there you have it. Our next one we're going to talk about is the composite or stratovolcano, often called the composite volcano because it's made up of alternating layers of lava and ash. These Volcanoes are capable of having both kinds of eruptions, these lava eruptions, as you saw in the Kilauea example, mixed with layers of ash that are ejected during other periods when other types of lava are more prevalent. And over time, they build up this kind of layered structure that is also unstable in some cases, and these mountains can be relatively explosive and dangerous. They're also called stratovolcano because they are they're layered or stratified, but they are also tall volcanoes, and it's interesting to think about them as, and some of the more famous volcanoes on Earth are actually, you know, kind of composed of this kind of composite layered structures. And so, let me get rid of this here thing. There you go. So you can see that you have a definite change in the shape. We're no longer talking about a broad shield, but rather a more stacked and actually arching, very graceful kind of arch as it reaches up towards the sky. These are very dramatic types of volcanoes, very, very scenic. They're usually covered with snow because they're fairly high in elevation. They intercept a lot of moisture, and we'll talk about these kind of qualities later. But you can also see, if you look at the diagram on here, that these have also the capacity to erupt on the side. And because they're made up of various layers, sometimes those layers are unstable and they can create flank eruptions and other things like that as well. But very dramatic, very beautiful volcanoes. Mount Fuji in Japan, or Fujiyama, is one of these types of volcanoes. There are a number of these as well in other oceanic settings, but they also occur on land where we have subduction occurring along a plate boundary. So again, a mixture of characteristics, not as much silica, maybe a little bit more, or a little less temperature as well, but they're in kind of the middle. This is Mount Fuji. This is the kind of famous shot that you always get from Japanese postcards and things like this. Is very dramatic, very beautiful mountain. You can see it in its setting, a kind of beautiful scenic vistas that come from this volcano type. So we have another short video to show you that kind of deals with our composite examples. So let's go back and watch.
Mount Vesuvius, outside the city of Naples in Italy, is an example of a composite volcano. Composite volcanoes alternate between quiet and extremely explosive eruptions. It sits near the boundary of two of Earth's tectonic plates, occupying a weak spot that lets magma from the mantle rise to the surface in a very dramatic way. On August 24th, 79 AD, an enormous chamber of magma far under Mount Vesuvius burst through its cone. The mountain's peak literally blew off. The thriving Roman cities of Herculaneum and Pompeii lay at the foot of the mountain. Over 50,000 people lived there. An explosive eruption called a pyroclastic flow hurled out rock, poisonous gas, and scalding ash. Buildings offered no refuge. They erupted in flames. In all, more than 16,000 people were killed. The volcano's victims were locked in time by the hot ash, their anguish preserved in molds left by their bodies. A column of smoke and ash hovered high above the city of Pompeii. Days later, rain fell, setting the ash like concrete and entombing the city until the 18th century, when the eerie scene came to light. Since this catastrophic eruption, Vesuvius has spit and sputtered lava and ash, but not with the deadly force of nearly 2,000 years ago. The next big eruption, though, might be just around the corner.
So, there you have an historical example of a composite volcano, and showing again how deadly they can be. But there are long periods of time where nothing happens, or the eruptions are relatively benign and not too impactful of, you know, the locality and things like this. So people kind of get used to them being there. And even today, We know that Vesuvius, as a composite volcano, is capable of erupting and will erupt at some point. People are moving up on the flanks of the volcano. They're farming. They're using the land there. And we'll see in our next hour when we talk about some historical examples how this catastrophe at Pompeii and Herculaneum has kind of cemented in our imagination and in our social kind of memory the dangers that are inherent in living around or near volcanoes. And this is kind of our reminder. And a lot of the images that you saw, the human bodies there were actually, what we call them, they're kind of spaces that were left as the lava hardened around them and the body decayed in that cavity. And people began to wonder what were these strange holes that they were encountering. And so they filled it with plaster of Paris, and I don't know what they were doing with plaster in Paris in Italy, but that's another story. And they filled them with plaster of Paris, and they, they then dug them out, and they realized these are bodies of the people that were there, the animals, everyone that did not escape were preserved there in these kind of voids. And so if you go to Italy, a lot of folks make the bus trip down to Pompeii and get an opportunity to walk, through their streets and see the preserved remains. And Herculaneum is now also being excavated in some areas because the city is growing and this whole metropolitan area is growing. So they come onto different parts of the ash and the lava that covered over part of that area. And it's also due to the descriptions of Pliny the Younger, who's really the first to describe a type of eruption that we will talk about in just a little bit, the pyroclastic flow. And even though it didn't have a name then and other people weren't quite sure what he was really describing, going back now, we're able to look at his words and realize that he's the first person to really describe this type of eruption, the very deadly pyroclastic flow. And so that's something to remember as we kind of move forward. And I guess before I go, I have a question from Marge. What is the difference between a crater and a caldera? Well, generally speaking, a crater is an area that's been evacuated or excavated by, an explosion or something. So in some cases, the caldera, the ancient caldera is the crater now. We'll talk about Crater Lake a little later on, but which is actually a remnant of a mountain that blew up in the Cascades in southern Oregon. And it now has a huge crater, but the caldera is where the magma is, and it's the kind of, if you look at the stratovolcano, it's either inside the volcano itself or below it. And the in the shield volcano, it sometimes is at the top of the volcano because the magma makes its way all the way up through the mountain and then kind of splutters over. So that's basically the difference. Roberto says, I stood on the lava at the edge of the Big Island, as in the picture in the text. I later found out this was very dangerous and tourists have died as large lava shelves fell in the ocean. Yeah, stay away from the edge. That's that would be my comment. People always, they like to go to the edge. And the problem with going to the edge is that the edges are not always secure. You may think of this as solid ground that you're standing on, but there may not be any support underneath, or the ledge may be fractured in different areas that you can't see. So if you go walking out there, you add your weight, there will be a reaction, and you could cause a collapse along that edge. So we can't put fences everywhere, and we do occasionally put signs saying, don't go out here, it's dangerous. There are places in the sunken city, for example, down in near San Pedro, where they warn people, don't get close to the edge. You don't know what is underneath. And so use common sense, try not to get too close to the edge, and don't wait too much. I don't know. But a good question, thank you. And thank you to Marge as well. So we're talking about a particular type of volcano, the composite or stratovolcano, and we've talked about the shield volcano. Let's talk about a third type, which is also pretty dramatic in kind of how it erupts, the volcanic dome. Probably the most famous example and probably one of the largest of this type is actually here in California. The Mount Lassen is a volcanic dome example, and here you see in 1915 or so when it erupted. This is the last time that Mount Lassen erupted in 1915. You can see the old car out there and people, you know, observing this this rather spectacular eruption. Plug domes or volcanic domes are actually built up of layer from underneath, and they actually can be very, very dangerous types of eruptions as well, and just depending on the size of it. And we have some historical examples we'll talk a little bit about in the next hour, but let's watch the video and kind of get some background about this particular type of volcano.
Someone was waiting for me. I had the answers to all of my questions. Love was so easy to see. I didn't know when I was younger, I should have known better. I thought that nothing was new. All the spaces and all of the changes, what I lost sight of was you. I didn't know, I didn't know I could see you in singing skies and dancing waters, laughing children.
I think we're actually supposed to start a little farther in, but at the 1351 mark, but that's okay. Kind of get the idea, which is more deadly, the volcano or the music. Well put. The thing about Lassen is that it's still active, and there are all kinds of volcanic features that are, you know, kind of directly observable there. So a lot of people still go and visit this. It's one of the least visited, though, of all our national parks. Who knows why? It's kind of remote. It's in kind of Northern California, up around, you know, between Susanville and Chico, in that kind of general vicinity towards Redding. And it has a spectacular background and landscape all around it. There's, you know, kind of boiling mud pots and smell of sulfur in the air. And, you know, it's tall enough that it has snow, you know, for a good part of the year. Sometimes, you know, even into the, you know, throughout the year, there's places where we have snow. And it's a place to go where there's not too many people. So if you'd like to visit your volcanoes in relative quiet and without too many people being around, there are no geysers there, which is another common associated feature, but they do have a lot of these boiling over waters and, you know, the travertine kind of layers of material. So it's a pretty interesting place on its own, and beautiful country, beautiful part of California to visit. But volcanic domes, like, and we're looking at Mammoth Mountain here, are basically built up of layers of, you know, both magma and lava, and they act as kind of plugs that hold down magma below the surface. And in this particular picture, we're looking at areas of dead and dying trees where scientists have decided that this is one of the areas where magma is fairly close to the surface near Mammoth Mountain. Now, a lot of people go skiing in Mammoth and they vacation up there and everything, and they're not really aware of the fact that Mammoth is in fact a remnant of a much larger volcano that erupted there tens of thousands of years ago. And it's called the Long Valley Caldera. It's about 10 miles wide and 12 miles long, hence the Long Valley kind of name. And when it blew up, it generated smoke and ash and, you know, material that is ejected all throughout, you know, the continental United States, almost as far as the Appalachian Mountains. And so it was a tremendous explosion and probably, you know, ranks with one of the largest eruptions. And you can see that Long Valley itself is the caldera, what was left after the mountain itself above blew up. And Mammoth Mountain started as a much smaller kind of plug where magma was still coming to the surface, and then built up over time. So there's, as you look at the interior of a plug dome, you can see that it's fairly, you know, uniform. It's all just you know, the magma that hardened into rock material, and there's a molten kind of core here, and the kind of throat where, you know, magma continues to move into that chamber. And if you go to Mammoth Mountain, you realize there are also hot springs, and hot springs is an indicator of something, which means that there's magma somewhere fairly close to the surface, enough to heat, you know, that groundwater to make it hot enough to call it a hot spring. And, you know, we have, you know, in our neighborhood, this kind of, not, you know, not too far away, that's probably our closest active or potentially active volcano. And even though it hasn't erupted in a very, very long time, the magma is still there. It moves around underneath, and it's a region where we have lots of relatively shallow earthquakes. And at one time, there was some concern in the 1980s about whether Mammoth Mountain would actually erupt or not. There were lots of warnings put out, and the U.S. Geological Society got a lot of heat because it never did actually erupt. People still like to throw rocks at them when they drive by in their trucks because, you know, it had a negative impact on property values, if you can imagine. You know, you don't want to invest in a retirement home if there's a volcano about to explode. So there were, you know, there's these kinds of other issues that come along when we talk about volcanoes, and they're interesting because, you know, people like them because they're dramatic and spectacular, and they make good skiing if you have snow, and they have a lot of natural service functions that we'll talk about later. But they're, you know, pretty amazing structures, and we are fascinated by volcanoes, like we are with dinosaurs, I guess, you know, big, you know, dangerous things. Our next type of volcano, though, is one that can range in size from very small to, you know, well, mountain size. So it's the cinder cone volcano. And generally speaking, cinder cones occur in areas where we have continental material. It tends to have a bit more, it tends to be more explosive. Here is a cinder cone nearby. This looks very much like the Amboy crater, which is on the way to Las Vegas. If you're taking Highway 15 out of, you know, Barstow, you can see it up there in the desert. There'll be a sign pointing the way to Amboy crater. So I can point out to you the lava flow. This is out here. One of the things that happens with these kinds of eruptions is that the magma can somehow, you know, kind of burn its way through a side vent or actually come from below and pour out onto the landscape. So you often have associated with these cinder cones an external field of lava that has flowed out as this kind of thing just suddenly appeared. There's another one on the way to Mammoth Mountain called Red Hill. It's just north of the 395, where 395 and the 14 kind of come together, and near a place called Fossil Falls, and a very active kind of environment there for a while in terms of volcanism. We have a flow of lava that we can see lava cliffs off in the distance, and we have this kind of red shaped cinder cone, which is also there. Now this is the Amboy crater. If you look at the picture down in the lower right-hand corner, you can see how the interior looks. You can see the kind of the caldera, the kind of pot of magma here, and then it's covered over with other material. And then during an eruption, this material will kind of be thrown out or ejected, and it kind of rolls down the side of the mountain. So it's pretty, that's why we have such a regular shape. It has that cone shape that makes it very a very definitive kind of feature on the landscape. Let's look at the video that we have for this one, hopefully without it, that kind of music on it.
Shield and composite volcanoes form slowly over many years. A third kind of volcano, called cinder cones, can emerge in just a few years. That's exactly what happened in the small Mexican village of Paracutin in 1943. A crack appeared in a cornfield. It began belching smoke and ash. This process marked the birth of a cinder cone volcano. A cinder cone volcano is a steep, cone-shaped hill made of volcanic ash and cinders that build up around a volcano's opening. Paracutin's pile of rock and ash began to rise. Within a day, a cone measured 12 meters high. A new volcano was born. Within a week, the cone rose 152 meters. After a year, the volcano had risen to 366 meters. It continued to grow. Even worse, it continued pouring out ash. 9 years after it was born, Paracutin covered almost 15 square kilometers of land. Then the eruption slowed and stopped, but not before whole villages had to be evacuated. It has not erupted since, but it's not dead either. At any moment, Paracutin could erupt again. A volcano can have a lifespan of over a million years. Unpredictable, it can lie dormant for hundreds of years, then explode, sleep for another few hundred years, and then erupt again.
So, and it's really pronounced Paracutin, and I remember it from elementary school. I don't know how many of you remember these weekly readers we used to get, but they were like little paper newspapers, and we would catch up on the news of the world in first, second, and third grade in our weekly reader. And the story of Paracutin, you know, beginning in a cornfield and by a Mexican farmer who was plowing, and then suddenly there's, you know, cinder and ash, and eventually covered the entire, you know, village that was nearby. And the people there had to relocate. So they took their patron saint from the from out of the church. And you see the church tower here, everything was covered up with ash and ejected material. And they went through the countryside, you know, hoping that the saint would lead them to another site where they could reestablish their village. And they did, but you had to negotiate with the neighbors that were already there. And they finally said, well, we'll let you come in. But this is still a fairly large volcanic peak that is active from time to time and ejects lots of material into the local environment, and it makes it relatively unsafe. So there, all you see of the top of the steeple of the church, the rest of the village is down below all that material. So they can be small, like an Amboy crater, or they can be very large and very active kinds of volcanoes. So there, again, are four basic types: the shield volcano, which occurs in oceanic settings, our composite or stratovolcano that can occur really in both, and then we have the volcanic dome, which tends to be mostly on land or continental settings, and our cinder cone volcano, which is again mostly on continental material. So that gives you the kind of lowdown on the four basic types of volcanoes, and I hope that you can think about how they're differentiated and put together. The next thing I'm going to talk about here are some of the volcanic features. And someone asked earlier, you know, what's the difference between a crater and a caldera? And again, I've gone through that. But again, the caldera is the place where the magma is, the magma chamber. The crater is kind of what's left after, you know, an explosive event or an eruption. And vents are usually on the sides of a volcano where magma traveling within the volcano makes its way out and forms what we call either a side vent eruption, Well, like Mount Shasta. Mount Shasta in Northern California is a volcanic peak, right, close to the border with Oregon. And you have a smaller volcano next to it called Shastina. It's kind of the little baby Shasta, which is really on a vent or a side of the mountain itself. These are places where we can get vents. And Kilauea is an example of also a vent where magma is still coming up and there's ongoing eruptive activity there. Hot springs and geysers are often, again, associated with volcanoes. It's where magma is close to the surface. Hot springs generally are the result of groundwater being heated. But geysers are interesting because they have a regularity usually that's caused by water filling up a chamber that gets heated by magma. And then when it comes to a boiling point, it's ejected. So here's one of the more famous geysers. Or if you're old, they call them geysers, like me. And we have this eruption that happens at regular intervals. So people know, hey, we got, half an hour till, Old Faithful erupts, so you want to go down there. And of course, there's traffic, and everybody wants to stand around at that particular moment to see the eruptive activity there, and the water just steam really going off into the sky. That's our fun day. Flood basalts are large areas of usually basaltic lava flows out in huge areas covered with this material. This happened a number of times in the past. We have a number of locations. The Deccan Plateau in India. This shows the interior of a geyser. I forgot to show you this. So groundwater fills in this area here. The heat kind of acts on that water, turns it into steam, and boom, you've got yourself a geyser. That's how it happens. So it's pretty cool, eh? So you don't want to get close to that, either. You don't want to get close to the geysers. I realize I have to warn you now. Don't get close. Don't go to the edge. Don't go to the geyser. Back to our, flood basalts. So in California, I was talking about the Deccan Plateau in India. So this is a very large area. This is a map image of the so-called Columbia River basalt flows. And these are outpourings of lava from these volcanoes and kind of behind the volcanoes flowing out over the landscape. So there's been the Snake River, for example, has been carving its way down through some of those layers of basalt that have just been poured out here. As the Juan de Fuca plate and the Gorda plate have been subducting underneath the North American plate, that magma has been rising towards the surface and flowing out onto the land. So this is basaltic lava. We have some in Northern California and Southern Oregon as well, in the so-called Modoc Plateau, which is up towards Mount Lassen in that area. Very flat landscape, lots of, there's lots of cavities in that and places where people used to hide. Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce tribe held out against General Bidwill, I believe his name is, who pursued them for 5 years out there trying to capture them and bring them back to the reservation. So these are also famous landscapes in American history. Robert wants to know, are any of the hot springs and palm springs associated with any volcanic activity? They're actually not with volcanic activity, but with, wait for it, the San Andreas Fault. San Andreas Fault has been producing its own kind of heat along there, and there are areas where we get that kind of buildup of pressure below the surface, and that will heat up water. Can any of these cinder cone volcanoes pop up anywhere? No, only where magma comes fairly close to the surface and the right kind of material, and it has to be kind of continental, more felsic, more feldspars and silicas that are there, and it'll be very explosive, and they will, from time to time. Mexico itself is in a very interesting zone because there are subduction zones off the coast in the area around Acapulco, and then you've got these chain of volcanoes that really made up that whole well, mostly from south of Sonora all the way into, well, Costa Rica and Panama, the kind of long line or chain of volcanic peaks, and that kind of activity that's a result of subduction along the along that edge of the plate there. But generally speaking, yeah, they won't occur everywhere. There'll be specified locations where magma comes close to the surface and where it burns through particularly continental type of material. But these flood basalts, again, very large areas, all throughout the world, some in South America as well. And then we talk about caldera eruptions. These are the very large scale eruptive events where the whole top of a mountain blows off. In this case, this is the kind of material that was ejected from the Long Valley Caldera. Long Valley Caldera is where Mammoth Mountain is located, and this shows you the kind of material that was erupted. So when the top of the mountain blew off, essentially, the material was thrown out. Now, there was ash that went beyond this, but this is kind of ejected material. This shows you how far up in the atmosphere it went. It must have been a tremendous explosion. And we'll see later on how this compares with Mount St. Helens, if you kind of remember this image, material heading out towards Omaha. Here you have another view showing the thickness of the ash that was produced by the Long Valley Caldera. And in fact, the so-called the Bishop area has a kind of Grand Canyon where the Owens River flows down through these layers of ejected ash material and rhyolite and other material that was the result of this huge mountain blowing up, creating the Long Valley Caldera. So more than 20 centimeters in depth in many places, or more. So where do we find volcanoes? Again, well, most of them are in the so-called Ring of Fire, all around the Pacific Plate. There are a number of zones where we have subduction occurring. This is where most of the world's volcanoes are located. In any given year, something like 90, 98 active volcanoes around the world erupting at some point during that year. You can see the big arc of the in the red here showing all the Ring of Fire volcanoes. And you know, other areas that include parts of Africa, the so-called, I'm going to show you out here. This is the East African Rift Valley. This is along the, a lot of people don't think of Saudi Arabia as having volcanoes, but they have a very active area there as well. There are some in Turkey, there are some in Greece, and of course there are some in the islands out there. We'll talk about those later. And of course you have Indonesia here, not traditionally viewed as part of the Ring of Fire, but there they are, all the Indonesian ones. Those tend to be muddier types of eruptions. A few along the mid-ocean ridge, of course, and some of those have, you know, popped up a year or two ago here in Iceland. That's the one that closed all the traffic down on air travel. And this is one of the dangers, of course, with volcanoes. They not only have local impacts, but they can you know, affect aviation. In fact, there was a flight that was leaving from the U.S. flying towards Japan. They flew over the Redoubt volcano, that's the name of it, on the Aleutian Island chain, and it flew through the ash cloud, and the ash actually blocked up and caused the silica and the ash to melt on the engines, and they were having, problems keeping the engines going, and eventually the engines, all four of them, went out. The plane went into a relatively steep dive. They figured the only chance they had was to kind of blow the ash off, and that was their chance, and they did all survive. But this one incident was the one that got the aviation authorities' attention, and now we have rules and regulations about flying through volcanic ash clouds, and they're very, very strict. They don't want to lose any people to something that's absolutely preventable. You know, just stay away. So even though the Icelandic volcano was, you know, has the long, unpronounceable name, did wreak havoc with commerce, and especially with travel over that year, it has since quieted down, and we've We didn't lose any airplanes and any people as a result. So it's a good thing that we do. So other regions at risk, you know, are places where we have maybe not subduction taking place, but some, you know, leftover remnants of magma below the surface still coming along. The big, you know, the big chain of, you know, volcanoes here in South America, very, very impressive. Lots of subduction taking place there. So, you know, most of the Andes Mountains, in fact, are volcanic in their basic composition. So what are the origins and effects of volcanic eruptions? What are the things that happen? Well, one of the most dramatic and, of course, most deadly aspects of volcanic eruption is not the lava. You know, the lava is dangerous and, you know, it's hot and it can cause fires and things like this. But most of us can walk away from the lava and safely, you know, get out of the way, especially when it's spreading out over the land and it's cooling off as it spreads. That slows it down. Lava tubes are, of course, a lot more dangerous because you have a concentrated, you know, amount of lava moving swiftly down a mountain slope, and so it's not going to, you know, be moving slowly. It's going to be moving fast, and the structures that form around it are capable of collapsing. So you shouldn't walk out onto, you know, and to get close to the lava flow. You know, you can also feel that the rock is still hot, so you don't want to like be walking on it anyway. But the most kind of dramatic eruption was in 1902 in the island of on the island of Martinique. The mountain was called Pelé, and it erupted not unexpectedly. It had been giving lots of warnings that, you know, it would probably erupt, but a really fascinating kind of eruption. And well, let's take a look at the video, and then we'll come back and talk about this type of eruption.
The 8th of May, 1902, Mount Pelé on Martinique in the Caribbean spits out a terrifying nuée ardente, a burning 400-degree cloud of ash, gas, and rock traveling down the slope at 200 kilometers per hour. Within minutes, the town of Saint-Pierre is flattened. The once splendid theater. After the eruption. Rue Victor Hugo. Only two people are known to have survived in the town, one of whom was Auguste Siparis, a prisoner in the jail. 28,000 others died, asphyxiated, crushed, or swept away. On the 30th of August, another nuée ardente devastates the village of Montrouge, killing another 1,000 people. In November, a needle of solidified lava rises slowly above the crater. In 1929, a new dome forms, and since then, the mountain has been quiet.
So there you have the story and kind of the upleading events. There's a political election that has to be held in May. The governor of the island is reluctant to kind of move people because of the election. They bring all the people into the town, and suddenly there's, you know, it's like May 8th, and the election's the next day or so, and suddenly there's a huge catastrophic event, and the pyroclastic flow in 90 seconds kills up to 30,000 people. The other person to survive was the ship captain. You saw his face there. He had gone below decks, just set his crew up in the rafters before the event to set the sails and kind of move out of the harbor. He had gone down to his cabin, and so his boat caught on fire. He was able to escape, you know, somewhat badly burned, but his crew and everyone else were killed. The prisoner was supposedly released as a result. It was seen as an act of God that had spared his life, so he was allowed to go free. Two questions from folks. I want to handle these before we go on break here. Is Lake Tahoe a crater? No, even though it looks like a crater from afar, and it's actually a a valley between two huge blocks that have been uplifted there, because the Sierra Nevada, remember, are uplifted blocks of mostly granitic rock, and we're in that zone called the Basin and Range Province. So we have these areas where blocks of material are thrust up, and then there's valleys created in between Basin Range. So it's not a crater, but it's beautiful, like Crater Lake. Robert wants to know, why is there nothing around or along the Arctic Plate? Basically because there is no Arctic Plate. I mean, there's the Eurasian Plate and the North American Plate, and we're not quite sure where the boundary of those two are, very clearly anyway. And also, there's a subduction zone there along the Aleutian Island Trench, so you've got all of the volcanism really concentrated there. And on Kamchatka, which is the peninsula that extends down from Siberia there on the Russian east. So that's kind of our look at pyroclastics. And we also have a short video here. It's only 57 seconds, so I think we can get here before one. There's a phenomenon called the Lahar, and something we'll talk about as well. We've already mentioned in context of Mount Rainier and the danger that comes from these volcanic mud flows that are generated as a volcano with snow on top actually erupts, and all of that snow and ice is vaporized essentially, and it falls as wet material, but it's also very, very hot, fiery, carrying debris down slope as well through established valleys, and we get danger as a result. So let's watch this short video.
After a sleep of 140 years, Nevado del Ruiz, an ice-capped volcano near the equator in Colombia, starts to come alive again in 1984. A year later, on the 13th of November 1985, an enormous lahar, a flood of mud caused by the melting of ice by the eruption, rushes out into the nearby valleys. The mud, up to 30 meters deep, blots out the small town of Armero in a few minutes. The human cost is appalling. 22,000 die at Armero, and 2,000 more at Chinchina. It is the most murderous eruption of the last 50 years.
So there you have an eruption that's very far away from the actual town that was impacted, flowing through the valley and out onto the plain where the town was located. A tremendous loss of life, totally unexpected. In the dark of the night, the sound and the roar of this wall of mud coming towards the town, volcanic material, ash and debris from upstream now carried down and out over the village. A terrible disaster for the people of Colombia. We also have associated with volcanoes, ash falls, layers and layers of ash that have built up. Sometimes they can lead to the collapse of structures. The ash itself may not be that heavy, but when it gets wet, as it happened at Mount Pinatubo, villages and towns got this soaking wet ash all over, and it began to cause roofs to fail, buildings to collapse, etc. Lava flows, of course. We know that they are associated with volcanoes. It's what we generally think about when we think about a volcano, lava flowing out. But these lava flows, generally can be managed, and we'll talk a little bit about that later on in the next class. One of the other dangers that many people are not aware of associated with volcanoes is the outpouring of poisonous gases, carbon dioxide, and other gases that have been generated within the earth can sometimes come to the surface and flow out over the landscape. And this happened in Cameroon at Lake Nyos. And let's see, I guess we could go ahead and show this and then go to break. How about that? And then we'll be where we're supposed to be. This is a story about Lake Nyos, and you can watch this and we'll talk about it when we come back.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jack Caravanos, and I'm a professor at the City University of New York School of Public Health in New York City. And I'm here today to describe one of the worst cases of natural asphyxiation ever. It all started about 9:30 p.m. on August 21st, 1986, when a tremendous volume of carbon dioxide gas was released from Lake Nyos, a crater lake in the northwest part of the central West African country of Cameroon. Lake Nyos is 208 meters deep and is one of three known lakes in the world to be saturated with carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide is naturally vented into the lake from deep within the Earth's crust, and in addition to saturating the lake, it also dissolves to form carbonic acid. The exact cause of the gas expulsion trapped below the lake is not known, but geologists have theorized that it may have been caused by unusual subsurface heat, a small explosion from magma, or a geologic tremor. On that day, 1.2 cubic kilometers of carbon dioxide gas, which is enough to fill 10 football stadiums or 716 World Trade Center towers, was violently released from below the lake. The gas was released in as little as 20 seconds and was said to have caused a 100 meter or 300 foot wall of water and foam at the shore. Carbon dioxide is 1.5 times heavier than air. So when the gas reached the surface, it followed the natural downhill terrain towards the villages of Nyos, Cha, and Sabum. People estimate that CO2 raced downhill at speeds of up to 50 kilometers or 31 miles per hour. The gas plume moved quickly, silently, and invisibly towards the villages. Carbon dioxide is not a toxic gas. However, when this gas, or any gas, displaces oxygen, then asphyxiation can occur. So as the plume moved downhill, it pushed aside normal air, which contains 20.9% oxygen, creating anoxic conditions. In this disaster, approximately 1,700 men, women, and children died of simple asphyxiation. Most died in their sleep as asphyxiation set in. Over 3,500 livestock also perished. By the time morning arrived, just about everybody in the plume's path died. With time, the carbon dioxide dissipated and atmospheric oxygen levels returned to normal. Afterwards, engineering controls were installed in Lake Nyos to vent the subsurface CO2 accumulation. The controls seem to be working. However, there's ongoing concern that the weakened earthen dam may rupture and flood the resettled villages downstream. Worldwide, geologists and environmental scientists have begun to identify other potentially hazardous volcanic lakes and institute preventative measures before this ever happens again. Well, thanks for listening to the presentation. Goodbye.
So, there you have the story of Lake Nyos, and he's the expert, and he's this person who studied the health effects of a volcanic eruption, which we don't usually talk about too much, but a tremendous disaster for that particular area and a kind of silent, unexpected kind of way. So when we come back, we'll be talking more about volcanoes and looking at some of the historical eruptions through time and look at how humans and volcanoes have interacted over time. So we'll see you in about 10 minutes or so.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Being new to this campus and my role as president, I have the same eagerness as an incoming freshman and the same nervousness that one has when you're taking on a new experience, especially one as big as this. And even though you've anticipated, you still have that sense of, you know, you hope you can do it well. People come to Dominguez Hills to get transformed. The dedication and the commitment of the Dominguez Hills faculty and the staff under daunting financial and operational circumstances is incredible. And how much more is this campus capable of? What can be done, what can be achieved for our students is boundless if we are all working together, sharing, communicating, focused. This campus has been tested under pressure, but the character that has been revealed is one of self-sacrifice, putting mission and students first. Good work has been done here in the past. Now, this is our turn. As we look forward to the future of this institution, let's build something awesome. Let's build something divine. As I said earlier, I don't have to do this job, I get to do this job. Being president of this university is an honor and a privilege, and I thank the people who made it possible, and I thank all of you who have been so gracious in welcoming me here. Thank you very much.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org. So opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment. We're doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. and that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
My name is Ileana Gutierrez. I'm a communications major here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I have my own radio show at KDHR, our on-campus radio station. The reason I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills is because of its beautiful campus and cultural diversity.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi. Welcome back. My name is Don Gauthier. This is SMT 312, Natural Disasters. We're in the second part of our Lecture 6, and we're talking about volcanoes and kind of the phenomena associated with volcanoes in the last part of our hour, today, and before our break, we were talking about the different aspects that are most destructive, including pyroclastic flow, lava flows, lahars, and we concluded with poisonous gases, in addition to, the material that's ejected from a volcano, ash falls, and things like this. If you'd like to get a hold of us and comment or add to our class, you can call 800-339-1193, or you could email us at askdhtv@gmail.com if you have a question or comment. If you're too shy to talk on the phone, that's fine. Been getting a lot of emails from folks, or you can tweet us at that's the DHTV Live, so at DHTV Live. And of course, after the broadcast is over, you could go to YouTube and you can see us on there and kind of relive the moment of watching our program. I hope that you take advantage of those resources and don't hesitate to call, whether you're a student or whether you're just kind of cruising by on Sunday afternoon and looking for other things that are on TV. Glad to hear from you. If you have questions or comments about the material, I hope that you're enjoying the presentation today on volcanoes. We have a few websites to visit before we go further into the class. One of them is, of course, the regular site for our USGS Science for a Changing World site, which looks at all the volcanoes around the Earth, but in particular focused on our coastline here and the Pacific Plate and the Ring of Fire, right? The so-called Ring of Fire that surrounds the Pacific Plate all the way down towards South America. But here they have them marked with the ends as being kind of normal activity or extinct are the other values out here. We have some that are increasing. They have advisories. In other words, they may erupt, become more forceful. So there's a number of these volcanoes. And of course, there's one here with an eyeball. It says, well, we're watching. We're watching that one. Of course, that one happens to be Kilauea. It's one we've been watching for a long time. And then you can go to different regions. You can look at the Mariana Islands here. This is along a trench, and the Mariana Islands are a volcanic island chain, or an arc rather, that is the result of subduction along there on the Pacific Plate. And you can go back to looking at various locations, including all the volcanoes in the U.S., and there we are. So that's one place that you can go. That's usgs.gov with volcanoes ahead of it. And if you go down to, let's see, we'll get it here, we go to our Volcano World. Volcano World is a site that's put together by the folks at Oregon State University. So it's volcano.oregonstate, all one word, .edu. So volcano.oregonstate.edu. And it's called Volcano World for a reason, because they have all of the volcanoes on Earth here with current eruption reports. They have a listing of all the volcanoes that they're kind of watching and aware of by alphabetic tables, so you can find one that's close by you. There's a listing by country. There's also a special subsite that looks at all the Central Andes volcanoes, which are particularly interesting because there's ongoing subduction there, and it's a pretty active area. And then, of course, they even have extraterrestrial volcanoes, you know, like, the one on Mars. So we're not the only place that has them. There's Mercury, they've got some. There's Venus. There's Earth's moon, there's Mars, and there they are, see? And Io, way out there by Jupiter. So you can get more information there. And of course, the list is very extensive of volcanoes. And then we have one that a student sent in. He sent a nice link here of folks that were actually, well, they call them daredevil photographers. I call them darn fool idiots. But they're out in the water near Hawaii, and they're taking pictures in the surf as lava flows out there. And it's dangerous only because this has also happened to folks that were working on the flanks of the mountain near Kilauea, and a very large kind of sea slide or an underwater landslide brought a lot of material down on top of them and almost, you know, killed them. But these are rather dramatic, very spectacular photographs of, you know, water and fire mixing there. And really what this is one of those natural service functions that, you know, we will be talking about later on, where, you know, new land is being created here. Here's the photographer. He's not too far away from that material. And there's floating rocks out here as well, you know, that are still very warm. You can get burned very badly. Whole bunch of different shots, very dramatic, you know, very spectacular shots of new material. This is, you know, this is getting too close to the edge here. See, you know, if you go out here, that may be enough to break off that section, so you don't want to go out there to the edge. You want to stay away from lava. It's very hot. I know it sounds very it's very obvious, but, you know, some people don't get it, I guess. I don't know. And of course, they see scientists out there trying to collect lava, you know, in kind of a hot state, and with long poles and buckets and things like this, just to catch whatever might be there that's transitory. Here's a lava flow following a kind of river, you know, an indentation here in the landscape. And again, lots of very spectacular pictures. And of course, what happens when it hits the water? Well, you know, as you imagine, lots of sparks and everything flying up, the long rivers of lava there, and more spectacular ones up on top of the mountain. But again, these are relatively safe kind of eruptive phenomenon. They are, the Hawaiian Islands in particular, a fairly good place to watch active volcanism, because we're not expecting any huge dramatic eruptions there, like at Mount Vesuvius or anything. And then finally, one that we'll, well, I'll just wait till the end and we'll go back to that. So that's good enough for us for now. But that gives you some place to go to look at this material, if, just to kind of augment what we've been talking about. In terms of historical eruptions, probably one of the most famous and one of the ones that has been undergoing the most research in the last couple of decades has been the realization that the destruction of the ancient civilization of the Minoans was probably due to the eruption of a spectacular volcano that made up the present-day group of islands, because it's actually in a caldera, around an ancient eruption that created the islands of Santorini, and or as it's known, I guess, in the Greek, as Thera. And this collapse of the dome and the caldera created a gigantic tidal wave that swept over and destroyed most of the Crete, the island of Crete that faced Thera across the Aegean Sea. So there's new evidence for this idea that Atlantis was actually in the Mediterranean, but on the other side of Crete, and that this story that is actually told by Plato, and this kind of gives it the credence, you know, that this actually was a real event, because Plato was not fond of lying and deceiving people, so we figure that this is probably something he said he was told by his father, and a story that had been passed down about this ancient civilization that was very advanced, that was wiped out by tremendous natural disaster. So let's watch this little segment of video. It's about 2 minutes long. We'll come back.
Phase began when the volcano's cone caved in. Seawater rushed into this inferno, creating a pressure cooker of superheated steam, which set off a massive explosion with the force of 40 atomic bombs. Phase 4. Raging avalanches of rock and debris, known as pyroclastic flows.
Evidence suggests that the volcano produced gigantic waves, 60 feet high. If people escaped by ship at the last minute, they never could have survived these tsunamis. The thickness of ash has proved that this was probably the largest volcanic explosion ever witnessed.
So, there you have the story of Thera, Santorini, and its connection with the demise of the Minoan civilization. And of course, the Minoans were all across the Mediterranean, so some of them, you know, later become or maybe associated with the term Phoenicians. And so we have a kind of leftover parts of their civilization, perhaps. And we have now evidence that the palace at Knossos and others were impacted and destroyed by the earthquake, the tsunamis, and you know, this totally amazing explosion, 40 atomic bombs. John writes in and says, with today's technology, what's the most significant event near a volcano that warns us the volcano is about to explode? In a sense, the most reliable precursor to volcanic eruption is, of course, the earthquakes that occur, and we get earthquakes that are generated by movement of magma below the surface. But we also get bulges in the landscape, so we look at those things. We look at other phenomena, the changing of groundwater, the heating up of hot springs. There's all kinds of things we can look for as kind of clues that a volcano is about to erupt. And not the least of which would be, you know, some minor eruptions before the major one. This is what happened at Mount Pinatubo. We had lots of warning beforehand. There was an evacuation put into effect because they thought, well, this could go all the way to a major eruption. And by doing that, really thousands of people's lives were saved by the early evacuation warning. Sasha writes in and says, what are the main points or evaluations that scientists use to determine the history of volcanoes? Well, a lot of it is written history. I mean, people have written about these volcanic eruptions in the past. We are able to look at the history of eruptive behavior. So we know that particular sediments are deposited, and ash and things like this, that we can carbon date if we can find bits and pieces of charcoal. So we can go back about 50,000 years or more or less get a reliable date. Things that took place before then are, of course, a little bit more difficult to date precisely, but we can do this using other methods and beyond carbon dating. And this is how we know about things like, you know, the Crater Lake Mount Mazama, which, you know, we'll talk about in a second. The eruption of Pompeii, Herculaneum, and Mount Vesuvius, or the eruption of Mount Vesuvius and the destruction of those cities, was really the result of this gap that happens to be in the African plate. So there's a place where magma can directly come towards the surface, and it's they call it a window. It's a place where magma, like a hotspot, but it's because the plate is moving. We don't call it a hotspot because, remember, hotspots are more or less permanent. Here the plate is descending, but there's a kind of gap there, and that's where the magma has come from to kind of create this. So we can watch this short video, and we'll come back and talk a little bit more about the destruction. And, you know, of course, it's Pliny the Younger who's actually writing about this event that becomes the foundation for our information about this this particular eruption. So let's watch this.
That final surge of ash turned Pompeii into a time capsule, preserving temples, shops, and houses exactly as they were in AD 79. The victims' decayed bodies left empty spaces in the hardened ash, which allowed archaeologists to make these ghostly casts. These are the final moments of the men, women, and children whose lives Vesuvius smothered. Vesuvius has had a dozen more eruptions since AD 79, but none has been as deadly. And none has been strong enough to stop a major city from developing in the shadow of Vesuvius. More than 1 million people live in Naples, just 8 miles from the volcano.
We know that Vesuvius is dangerous. Indeed, we expect an eruption very soon, but what you can do?
Scientists say one more big eruption could swallow the metropolis in less than a minute. But they have no idea when.
So there you saw the pyroclastic flows that Pliny the Younger also described, but we really didn't quite understand until very recently, until 1902, when we had more eyewitnesses to this event. In addition, if we look at the image of modern day Naples, and you can see in the satellite imagery that we have this tremendous urban area around the mountain itself, and people are actually moving up on the flanks of the mountain to take advantage of the kind of, you know, the soils that are there, because, you know, volcanoes produce good soils. Robert's writing in and says, Anastasius Kircher's map of Atlantis placed it in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean between the African and North American plates, runs north-south down the approximate middle of the Atlantic. Is it right? Well, probably it wasn't Atlantis. The reason that people put it out into the Atlantic Ocean, you know, has to do with the fact that it describes that it's beyond the gates of Hercules. But that could be a translational error. That could be just something that happens in the, you know, passing down of the story from generation to generation. But because no one had seen this other advanced civilization, and maybe that's, you know, because it had disappeared. And but nothing really disappears. Just like, you know, the Anasazi, they're really, well, the Hopi and the others that are there. They don't disappear, but the civilization may disappear. We'll still be around, you know. You're right, that's exactly where people have placed it for a long time. People have said that the large objects out in near Bermuda that look like blocks are actually part of ancient Atlantis, but they've shown that this is really just a natural thing that happens with limestone, which is in a, you know, under the ocean there. So I don't know if we have that image, but I guess we don't. Maybe we do for Vesuvius. The one with the map, the aerial satellite photograph, if we have that one. This shows what, you know, an artist's rendering of the destruction that was beginning to occur. This is the satellite map. The black is the Bay of Naples. The red sore there looking like an eyeball is actually Mount Vesuvius. You get an idea of how large it is relative to the surrounding area. All the areas in blue or kind of light gray that are on the map are urban areas. And the red indicates usually vegetation and trees and things like this. So you can see that there's, you know, it's a rather dramatic and very spectacular kind of, well, disaster waiting to happen, huh? Let's move on. We'll talk a little bit about Mount Mazama. Mount Mazama, again, a prehistoric eruption, blew off the top of the mountain and of course, created as a result a lake known as Crater Lake. If you've ever gone there, it's a very beautiful lake, very clear water. Why is it so clear and clean? Well, it's all rainwater. It's all melt water from snow and rainwater. There are no streams that flow into it. In the middle of this image here, you can see an island that's called Wizard Island. It itself is a kind of plug dome, kind of like, you know, this is formed after the eruption of the and the disappearance and collapse of the top of the mountain. This was there, and it really acts as a kind of plug and holds the magma below the surface. It is no longer an active volcano. It's blown itself up, but there are, you know, other things that could happen if, you know, magma in the area began to move in that general direction. So Mount Mazama becomes Crater Lake, and a very spectacular place and a nice place to visit. Yellowstone is also one of those areas that is high on many lists of folks, and Yellowstone is the site of our mega volcano. Here we have a hotspot in a continental setting. This shows what happens when we have this material pushing up from deep within the earth. This magma is basaltic in origin. It encounters continental material, this granitic magma on top, and there are numerous faults around here. You have the caldera marked here on the side, so this area in between is the caldera. And in the caldera you have geysers and a resurgent dome. This is the new dome that wants to build itself up. And you can see a lot of other kind of phenomenon here, including the stretching of the crust, you know, which is a pretty interesting phenomenon. It also marks the distinction between, remember those types of strain we talked about? You know, plastic and brittle, talking about how that operates in this particular setting. The Yellowstone mega volcano, and it's called that because of its size and the fact that this you know, the North American plate has been moving over this hotspot. So there have been other eruptions in the past. We still view Yellowstone as active, and so it is a zone that is monitored. This is the beautiful caldera. It's a nice big open valley with the Yellowstone River moving through it. Very beautiful, lots of, you know, buffalo and, you know, other wildlife there, including tourists who stop unexpectedly to watch the wildlife. We can watch this short video, about a minute and 20 seconds or so.
Yellowstone is the nation's first and largest national park. It receives almost 3 million visitors a year. At 3,000 square miles, it is larger than Rhode Island and Delaware combined. What most people don't know is that Yellowstone is also the home of a supervolcano, a volcano that can eject more than a trillion tons of material and can cover an entire continent with ash. Supervolcano magma bubbles close to the surface, but a large mass of rock prevents it from breaking free. This happens over hundreds of thousands of years until finally it blasts its way out. Scientists have estimated that the Yellowstone supervolcano explodes once every 600,000 years. We are overdue. It last exploded more than 630,000 years ago. This supervolcano's hotspot extends miles below the surface, nearly halfway to the center of the Earth. The hotspot is the fuel that heats the park's famed geysers, hot springs, and the supervolcano. Scientists search for answers. They research ways to relieve the supervolcano.
So you have a volcano that stretches halfway down to the center of the Earth. It also happens to be on the 45th parallel, which is also halfway between the North Pole and the equator. And this is ground zero for a mega volcano, which would have impact well beyond that little corner of Wyoming. Mount St. Helens. This is covered extensively in your textbook. Lots and lots of information on Mount St. Helens. I'm not going to have time to go through all of it, but you should look it over. And because this is one of those cases in which the U.S. Geological Survey actually made a guess about the time of eruption and did it within an hour or 45 minutes of when they said it would erupt. And that's getting pretty close to being able to predict, huh? Mount St. Helens. Up in Oregon and actually in Washington State, but up past Oregon, it is an area that has been heavily forested and filled with wildlife and, you know, a recreational area. Beautiful lake there called Spirit Lake. Lots of good fishing, etc. You know, it was a place where people went. And then in the 1980s, beginning in 1980, it began to become active, and it erupted in 1980 with a spectacular eruption caused by the failure of the north flank of the volcano. So we're going to see a little video that shows that and how that happened.
There is a certain fatalism amongst geologists, though, that work around these volcanoes. As we all know, that if you're going to work around one that's getting ready to erupt, there's some risk.
Richard's colleague, David Johnston, was also on the mountain.
David Johnston was up on this ridge, you know, just a quarter mile from where we are now, and he was monitoring Mount St. Helens in an official capacity.
David had parked his trailer in front of the volcano's north flank, keep an eye on an ominous growing bulge. That same day, amateur photographer Keith Ronholm made his way to a scenic spot, also overlooking the volcano's north flank.
We're at Bear Meadow, where I was 28 years ago in 1980. I was 10 miles from the mountain. It seemed like a perfectly safe place to be.
But just after 8:30 that morning, the last of a series of earthquakes hit, triggering one of the largest landslides in recorded history.
I glanced over at the mountain, and the entire north face was in motion, was sliding down. And it's such an unbelievable view that I like shook my head and I said, Am I really seeing this?
So in that particular eruption, you have a landslide triggering the actual eruption of material from within the mountain, but the magma moving up through the mountain gradually weakened the structure of the mountain and began to collapse. So this is Mount St. Helens when it was, you know, nice and beautiful and a fully developed mountain. Now, some years later, it's still recovering, and you can see the, you know, the composite kind of dome structure of the mountain. And then if we go to the next slide, you can see the mountain at present. This is with the kind of the whole north face kind of collapsed out in front of the mountain there. And the vast area that was kind of just trees were snapped, and you know, that everything was just destroyed out of that direction. And unfortunately for David Johnston, he was there, you know, in the direct force of that blast, that lateral blast. If you can imagine, you know, the force of it actually snapping trees and in half and everything else. So probably killed pretty instantly as a result of it. The Mount St. Helens eruption is probably one of the largest in recent history in the United States. And we are, the landscape is still repairing itself after this thing. So we have flowers finally coming back. Some of the forests are starting to grow back and that were impacted. But the lahars that came down from here have, you know, changed things downstream as well. So lots of other things. So I want to move quickly to the next topic, which is Mount Pinatubo, without going through the slides on Mount St. Helens, and talk about one that happened a little more recently in the Philippines, Mount Pinatubo and its eruption. So here we're seeing the actual eruptive force, the original blast in June of 1991, also coincided with a typhoon, which is a tropical storm a lot like a hurricane, as it came on shore. And this doubling up of, you know, a natural underground phenomenon, and then this tropical rainstorm generating lots and lots of mud and everything else, created lots of problems and lots of deaths in the Philippines, even though many people had been evacuated. Both the Subic Bay Naval Base and the Clark Air Force Base were, of course, impacted heavily by this. Most of the folks at Clark were evacuated beforehand. There was a kind of skeleton staff to maintain security. Downstream from the mountain, lahars wiped out towns and villages. Ash falls caused roofs to collapse. People were killed in their homes. This was a devastating event in the Philippines on the North Island of Luzon. Now, so that's what we'll do. Let's watch a short video, the 144.
Each volcano is different, and each volcano is going to behave differently, and so that timing is going to be different each place, and that's really going to be hard, because you know you're going to have false predictions. You're going to say it's going to erupt and then nothing's going to happen, and everybody's going to go, oh, those scientists, they didn't know what they were talking about, and then it's going to go.
June 1991, the Philippine island of Luzon. Mount Pinatubo woke from a 600-year nap. The Luzon volcanic explosion killed 900 people, destroyed 42,000 homes, swamped 100,000 acres of cropland with ash, and caused an economic loss in the billions of dollars. But it could have been worse.
The prediction was made that it was going to erupt, and it was going to erupt big, and it was going to erupt soon. And fortunately, the volcano did exactly that. It erupted big and soon. But to a great degree, we got lucky there. Had it waited just a few days, the people that were evacuated, they were farmers. They had no food. If they didn't go back to their land, they had nothing to eat. So had the prediction not taken place, I mean, had the actual eruption not taken place literally right when it was predicted, if it had been 2, 3, 4 days later, those people would have all gone back to their farms, so they would have had something to eat, and then they'd have been killed.
Okay, so So why do we hang around volcanoes anyway? Why is it that people find themselves always at risk? Well, there are a number of reasons. First and foremost, that a lot of natural harbors are created by the calderas that are left of ancient volcanoes. I think I mentioned earlier in the course that Edinburgh, Scotland is actually a city that's actually occupying an ancient extinct volcanic caldera. The other aspects that include just how beautiful they are. People like to look out and see mountains, and volcanic peaks have their own special attraction. They're just, they're beautiful to look at. Because of their altitude, they also are able to intercept rainfall, and many of them are snow-covered if they're tall enough. And even in the tropics, this is the case. And glaciers and, snowpack creates fresh water for communities that are living down below the mountains. There's also the recreational factor. Mountains provide that additional lift and altitude that you want when you're going to go skiing, and so it makes for good not only hiking but also good skiing for folks. As a result of volcanic eruptions, ash and other material provide generally fertile soils. Most of the material that's coming up from deep within the earth is material that can be easily eroded and becomes soils fairly quickly, and so these are positives for production of food. I mentioned already that water is an important byproduct of these volcanoes as well, and then of course there are the minerals that are also exposed and released and made available to folks for other things besides agriculture. So in fact, in Ecuador, if I recall, there's a volcano that's been extruding lava that has a very high gold content, for example. This is something that people want to know about, right? So these natural service functions are important. They are one of the reasons that we continue to occupy the same kind of general vicinity as a volcano, in spite of the threat that it poses for humans and their creations. How do we mitigate against volcanoes? Well, traditionally, there's not been much that we could do. We have the only option is to flee the immediate eruption zone to get as far away as possible to be safe from all of the effects. But some of these effects can be very widespread and can last a very long time. Some eruptions, like the recent Icelandic volcano that no one can pronounce or name, and hence shall not be named, has actually interrupted trade and commerce, and travel, and so it had an economic impact. And then finally, we've found that we can sometimes change the direction of flow of lava. We can, make things happen better. So we have about 90 seconds left, and you're just going to have to wait till next time to find out how we did that. I want to go to our Great Shakeout page to remind you that this coming Thursday, the October 18th at 10:18 in the morning, there will be a nationwide, but here in California in particular, California Shakeout to prepare people for disaster. So just want you to do that. We will post the midterm on Tuesday, and it'll be due on 10:20, which is Saturday night, at 11:59 p.m. It'll be on chapters 1 through 6, and we'll kind of get back to you on all those things. So next week we'll be talking about floods and flooding. There is no quiz this week, just the midterm. I'll give you more information online when I do post it. So that's it for today. I'm very pleased that so many of you took the time to email in, and I'm grateful that you folks are out there. I hope that you have a great day and a great week. Don't forget the Shakeout on Thursday, and see if you can go to their website and you can sign up and register there. So take care. See you next time. Bye-bye.